Back in the day, when any program crashed in Windows, it would ask you if you wanted to send an error report or not, and no one ever knew if it made any kind of difference. These days, error reporting still happens, but it's all in the background and automatic, which might lead you to wonder, what the heck is in those error reports anyway? Well, in this video, you'll find out, so you can become a true expert, but don't worry if you don't understand everything, I'll explain the important stuff in a way that everyone can understand. Now, first of all, what's the point of error reports anyway? Well, they are actually critically important to discovering software bugs and fixing them. To really narrow down the cause of a problem, developers want to know as much as possible about exactly what the program was doing when it crashed, plus some other info about the computer, in case it only happens in some version of Windows, for example. As for where the reports go, there was a question and answer post done by a researcher at Microsoft that put it simply, it goes into a giant database that then gets mined by some incredibly clever software, and thousands of bugs get fixed based on those reports. He also said third-party developers can even sign up to get access to the database so they can fix their bugs too. Now, that post is 10 years old, but I'm sure it more or less works the same today. So they're not only used by Microsoft to fix potential bugs in the operating system, but also software development companies can register their software and get error reports related to their software specifically. So for example, if they push out an update and then all of a sudden start getting a ton of error reports all from users with a specific GPU, that will clue them in that maybe something in the update is causing the problem. But it might also show that it only happens to users who aren't up to date on their graphics drivers, so they can even tell users the way to fix it is to update those. So they are definitely helpful. All right, now let's go over exactly what happens when a program crashes, and then go over what exactly is in an error report, and where you can find them on your own computer. And again, don't worry if some of this sounds complicated, especially at the beginning. You definitely don't have to follow everything or remember any of the names of things. So, the first thing that happens when a program, aka a process, crashes, is it calls a function built into Windows called wrp_report_fault. The name isn't important, but WHERE stands for Windows Error Reporting, and since this is the entry point to the error reporting procedure, I figured I'd mention it. Then it will check to see if Windows Error Reporting Service, called WHERE SVC, is running. And by the way, a service is just a program or process that only runs in the background and has no graphic user interface, it's all behind the scenes. If the service isn't already running, it will then start up, and then it will communicate with the crashing process like, whoa, what just happened? And then it will call some other functions that we can skip over, and eventually calls the process wrp_fault.exe, which is important because this is what does all the work with the reporting the crash. Okay, fortunately at this point it gets easier to explain in simpler terms. So this wrp_fault process then collects a bunch of info about the crash, which we will see later. This includes information about the exception, which is the thing/scenario that caused the crash, or in other words, an exception is something that happened that interrupted the program's normal procedure. And fun fact, if you've ever seen a program spit out an error saying unhandled exception, it simply means the program ran into something that isn't normal, the exception, such as trying to write a file and not having permission, and the programmer literally didn't write any code to handle it. So it's an unhandled exception. And quick side note, if instead the programmer anticipates that particular scenario, they can write an extra bit of code called an exception handler to deal with it. So with our example, if the program can't write to a file, instead of crashing, the handler might have instructions to simply show a pop-up telling the user it doesn't have permission and to try saving it somewhere else. So if you do ever come across an error that says unhandled exception, consider reporting that to the developer, especially if it keeps happening, assuming they have some place to report bugs, because it means they didn't anticipate that problem, but can probably fix it. Before we continue, I want to thank today's sponsor, Blinkist. Now, I definitely don't get around to reading as much as I want, even though I know there's plenty of books with good ideas out there. So if you're the same way, that's where Blinkist comes in. It's an app that takes thousands of the top nonfiction books across 27 different categories and creates much shorter text and audio explainers they call Blinks for each one, as well as producing shortcasts, which are Blinks for podcasts. Each Blink is around 15 minutes, but you can even speed that up if you want. And in that time, you'll learn the biggest takeaways and most powerful ideas from the book. A few Blinks I've listened to recently are Deep Work, The Myth of Sisyphus by Albert Camus, a classic, and one that I'd legitimately recommend, not just because this is sponsored, which is Crucial Conversations. It's a book that I've read before, so listening to the Blinks was a great refresher for me, and will definitely give you the major concepts discussed in the book, which is basically about how to not blow it when having high-stakes conversations in everyday life. It's super valuable. So, if you want to check out Blinkist, go to blinkist.com/theojo to get a one-week unlimited free trial to try it out. And the trial is completely free, and you can cancel at any time, but just for you all, if you decide to get a premium membership, you'll also get 25% off that. So again, go to blinkist.com/theojo, and the same link is down in the description. And now, let's continue. Alright, so after the Werfault process collects some initial information, the next thing it collects from the crash is a so-called memory dump, which is basically what data was in the memory or RAM during the crash. So this includes functions the program just called, and sometimes the actual values of variables in the program, which is called a heap. Put simply, during a memory dump, the crashing process just says, here, just take everything I was working on, you go figure it out, and dumps all that info into a file. Now, memory dumps in the error reports don't actually contain everything in the memory at the time. I mean, not only would that be a huge security issue because it includes data from every other program running on the computer, but also every error report would be huge. So instead, the error report only takes a very small fraction of the info and only that related to the crashing process itself. There is other stuff that the error report probably contains though, including loaded modules and stuff, but we should move on for the sake of time. So now onto where the reports get saved. And that is in the location C/program data, which is a hidden folder by the way, /Microsoft/WER. In here, there are actually three directories, report archive, report queue, and temp, but only the first two matter. New error reports first go into the report queue directory, and after it gets sent to Microsoft, it gets moved into the report archive folder. If there is no internet connection, it just stays in the report queue folder until it can send. Now, each error report gets its own folder, so if you look in the report archive, you'll see a bunch of folders, each one representing a crashed process. In each folder, there will also be at least a report.where file, which contains all the important information and metadata about the crash, and sometimes there will also be additional info, such as the memory dump we talked about before, but not always. So now let's get to the thing you're really wondering about, which is what's inside one of these report files. So you can just open it with Notepad and whoa, I know what you're thinking, you gotta be kidding me, what the heck am I even looking at? Well, we're not gonna go over all of this obviously, just a few of the important ones that I looked up and was able to actually understand and seemed important, and that also are easy to explain. You can probably figure out what a lot of these are for just by the name, like time, report ID, stuff like that. But one of the big ones to look at is actually near the bottom, the app name and app path entries. So with this example, I had no idea what CEP HTML engine was, but here I can see that it's used by Premiere Pro. So this must have been a sub-process while running that. Another one that seemed relevant was report type. Without getting too technical, it identifies one of six types of crashes, such as a non-critical error that just happened in the background and the user probably never even saw, or a application crash or hang where the program stopped running or stopped responding, which are error messages you probably have seen before. Plus there is a few others that you can read here, but I couldn't really find any more information about these report types. Loaded modules is also usually important. A module is basically a subcomponent of a program that does a certain task. An analogy you can think of is how in a company, there are different departments. In this case, the module that crashed was cephtmlengine.exe, which turns out to be for the Chromium Embedded Framework, and basically serves as a mini web browser you can include with and embed inside programs. So a module can also be something that might be included with all sorts of programs. So it's kind of part of the program, kind of not. In our analogy with a company, you might consider this an independent contractor, if that makes sense. Anyway, the name loaded modules should be self-explanatory, but it shows all the modules that were loaded at the time of the crash, and always with the actual crashed one at the top, from my understanding. This is useful, for example, if all the error reports with the crash have a certain module loaded, so maybe that means it's interfering. Or on the flip side, maybe it's because it's not loading a module that is supposed to be loaded. The final one we can talk about are buckets and bucket ID. This seems to be especially important, and I'll explain why, though it's a bit abstract, so hopefully if you've made it this far, you can bear with me. The term bucket, which will make sense later, is short for fault bucket, and it's essentially an identification number that automatically is calculated by Windows based on the specific circumstances of the error. For example, when calculating it, it takes into account the program that crashed, the version number, and what location in the actual code that the program crashed, plus other factors. And the idea is to try and group different crashes based on the actual root cause of the crash, not just the error itself. So say there is some specific type of error that keeps happening to users, but maybe not all of them happen at the same time in the program, and they might not even have the same root cause. Windows will do a bunch of fancy calculations with the available info and generate a bucket ID for the error, where other crashes will also have that same bucket ID if the same type of circumstances result in that error, and therefore it's probably the same exact cause. The reason they're called buckets is it's like you put these crashes into this bucket together because they're probably the same thing, and then these other crashes into another bucket. So to better understand, imagine a developer wants to fix a bunch of bugs from a bunch of error reports. Instead of looking at one crash and then trying to manually find other crashes he thinks are related, which might end up being a wild goose chase, he can just look at the crashes with all the same bucket ID. So it's way easier to find the same root cause in all of them, most likely. Plus, it makes it way easier to figure out how many separate bugs are out there, because you might have a super common crash that generates a million error reports and not know if it's a million separate bugs or just one. And going back into the error report file, I do believe that this SIG and dynamic SIG values are at least some of the information used in calculating this bucket ID, but I'm not 100% on that. So that's my understanding of bucket IDs at least, but I'm sure there's way more that goes into it that I'm not qualified to explain. As for the rest of the info in there, if you know I missed a really important one, definitely leave a comment and let me know. Otherwise, you can just look through the file yourself and maybe look up some of the other stuff yourself if you can actually find any info about them. Thanks again to Blinkist for sponsoring this video. Again, be sure to go to Blinkist.com/TheoJoe to get an unlimited 7-day free trial and 25% off a premium membership. If you want to keep watching, I'd recommend checking out my video about the hidden super shortcut feature in Windows called Symlinks, so be sure to check that out right there. Also consider subscribing and enabling notifications with the bell. I post videos about once or twice a week. So thanks so much for watching, guys, and I'll see you in the next one.